bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Por la Via Dolorosa, triste tiene Jerusalem. Los soldados la bria paso a Jesús. Mas la gente se acercaba para ver a que llevaba que la cruz. Por la Via Dolorosa, que es la via del dolor, come ave, avino Cristo, Rey Señor. Y fue él quien quiso ir por su amor, por ti y por mí. Por la Via Dolorosa, al Calvario.
Scripture reading that we'll read now is the cross. It comes from Luke 23:33-46. When they came to the place called the skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." Soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, then save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about the sixth hour. The darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, for the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last.
Dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, torn by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross, Christ became
Happy Good Friday. You know, the day we celebrate the death of Jesus Christ, doesn't that sound ironic? Happy Good Friday. Especially when we read scriptures from the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy. Now, if a person has committed a sin carrying a sentence of death, he is to be put to death, and you hang him on a tree, and his body is not to be left overnight on the tree, but you shall certainly bury him on the same day, for he who is hanged is cursed. The Lord Jesus Christ, the promised Messiah from the Old Testament, Jesus Christ, the New Testament Savior of mankind, was nailed to a tree. He was counted as one who was cursed, and according to the Bible, a cursed man should die on a cursed tree. It was sinful, guilty men, the Romans, at the urging of the high priest who took away the life of Jesus, our Lord. And do we understand that at Lincoln Community Church, we believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Amen. And when we think about the death of an innocent man dying an awful death that was meant for others, we might pause to consider this to be the chief of all sad days. Because there are many men and women that look upon the day of remembrance with depressing tears. You would never know this, but our pastor has worked so hard during this Easter season. Just tonight, it is so perfectly clear. He's picked out these scripture passages for us to get the story so that we might understand it completely, from the Old Testament prophecy to the declaration that Peter said, "You are the Son of God," to the trial and then to the cross. And you would never see what he does. But my gosh, he brings the word of God to us so clear. And tonight, I would never deny that Good Friday is certainly the worst named holiday in the history of mankind. But I'm not sure that the God of heaven ever enjoys his children to look back at the events of this day with gloomy sorrow. You see, today, 2,000 years after the event, we know more than those who witnessed the death of Jesus Christ. We are like Paul Harvey. We have seen the rest of the story. Amen? There is enough. Maybe there's too much unhappiness in this world today, and adding any more sadness could easily break the hearts of mankind. But believe it or not, there is joy in the Lord as we remember that on this day, Good Friday, mankind has gone from an old covenant, the old way of doing things, and we've moved into the fresh, new promise of God. And this promise is eternal life, and it rests on the shoulders of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. So maybe, just maybe, today we should be a little bit more joyous as we celebrate this occasion than we ever thought possible before, because we know how it ends. And maybe this should be the beginning of a holiday weekend that begins with joyful enthusiasm and ends with a cheerful celebration. And you know, I get it. As we remember the death of Jesus Christ, some people might say, "Gee, Pastor, don't you think that a funeral dirge would be a little bit more appropriate as we start the holiday weekend?" They might say, "Why start Easter weekend with a festival rather than commemorating the death of anyone, especially our Savior?" But if we pause for just a moment and we go back to the New Testament in the book of Luke, Jesus was celebrating a festival. That's what he was doing on this night. He was celebrating the festival of Passover at his Last Supper with his apostles.
This is the holiday that we call Good Friday. It is the holiday that Jesus called Passover. And for thousands of years, it has always been a holiday weekend, and Jesus was celebrating. Acts, or Luke 22. And when the hour came, Jesus reclined at the table, the apostles with him, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. There were difficult moments ahead of Jesus. He knew that his life would soon be taken away from him. But look at the fact that this meal was something that Jesus was eagerly looking forward to. Jesus knew that the time of his death was near, that his burial was close. And there's no doubt that he realized what was about to happen. It was all part of what was planned by the Heavenly Father. But Jesus knew that on the other side of his death, there was life eternal. There was something that Jesus was looking forward to on the night of his arrest. There was something that Jesus was looking forward to before his death. And Jesus did not retreat into a darkened corner. Jesus did not contemplate his death. He did not complain about his future. He knew that there were difficulties ahead, and he did not shy away from them. Instead, he even looked forward to them. And even his life was something that he would gladly lay down for others. You see, Jesus knew that you have to spend something. He knew that you had to sacrifice something if you get what you want. It was true for us, or it was true for Jesus. It's true for us. And so, yes, the last Passover, Jesus knew that it was time to die. But he eagerly sat down with his apostles. To Jesus, this moment was special. It was his to share with the men that God had given him during the last 3 years. And I know that it sounds like a paradox to say that Jesus was looking forward to the events of this weekend, even though death was a few short hours away. And for us, we see that as sadness. But on Good Friday, Jesus didn't. So what did Jesus do for us on Good Friday, the day before his death? Jesus established an ordinance of the church that we have observed for 1,000 years. We call it the Lord's Supper. Some people call it communion. Other people take comfort in the fact that they use the term the Eucharist. Jesus plainly spoke about how we would and how we should remember him on Good Friday. You see, on this weekend, Jesus put into practice what had been planned from the very beginning of time. He put into motion God's proposed eternal life through the death of a Savior. And so Jesus gathered his apostles together, and he sat down with them, and he said, boys, you have no idea how much I've been looking forward to eating this Passover meal with you. And he said, it's the last supper that I will ever eat until we eat it together in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus had looked forward to eating his last Passover meal with his apostles, but he was excited because he knew that he would sit down with them once again in the kingdom of heaven at the Master's table. He was not eating a meal served at a funeral for a friend. Jesus was sharing a victory dinner before anyone else knew what he knew. And so Jesus, the Son of God, the Messiah, our Savior, he looked forward to this night. Have you ever bought a present, a special present, for your husband or your wife or your child, and it's not just a regular birthday gift, it's not just a regular Christmas present, it's something special, and you hand it to your loved one, and as they start to take the paper apart, there's so much excitement you can hardly stand it yourself? Do we understand? That's exactly the kind of excitement that Jesus was feeling on the night before his death. Eternal life was only a few precious moments away from the apostles. The Passover was something that Jesus had been looking to for a long, long time. It was a good day for Jesus. Good Friday. And we know that Passover might be the biggest holiday on the Jewish calendar. It celebrates the Jewish slaves' exodus from Egypt. But did you know it's not only considered to be a historical event, not just something that kind of happened in history. It's supposed to be experienced as an event of life. In the Jewish Passover ceremony, it is said that everyone at the Passover should celebrate as if he or she at this moment is leaving slavery and entering into freedom. See, that was the Passover, a personal experience of freedom. And for us today, Good Friday. It's not a historical event. It's a personal experience as we celebrate the fact that we have left behind the elemental things of this world, that we are being ushered into the kingdom of God. At Passover, the Jews celebrated as if they had personally left slavery and were walking into a new life. Just as we should celebrate entering into an eternal life with Jesus Christ. You see, Good Friday is not a historical event. It's a personal experience. And that can't be a sad thing. And if you're still not sure that it was time for Jesus and the apostles to enjoy, to celebrate, think about what Mark wrote in Mark 14:26. And after singing a hymn, they went to the Mount of Olives. Jesus and his apostles went away from the Passover table with glad hearts, praises to God and a hymn on their lips. It was Jesus who was celebrating the day, and his joy was contagious to his disciples. Could we? Should we do anything other than what Jesus did? Than to celebrate and to sing. There was death, of course, but there is life. There's eternal life. Because you see, on Easter morning, no one's walking out of a tomb unless someone's been buried in the tomb. So what is the preacher saying today? I'm saying what Charles Spurgeon said. At the memorial of Christ's death, it should be a festival, not a funeral. On Good Friday, we should remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Instead of being gloomy and sad and somber, we should rejoice. Because of Christ's death, we can have a new life, a life eternal. And that's something to celebrate. God be praised.
that night that Jesus gathered in the upper room, he instituted what we call the Lord's table or Eucharist or communion. And it was meant to be a time that they would remember from that point on. Perhaps the best summary of it is what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 11 when he wrote, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'The cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Good Friday is the day in which we remember Jesus going to the cross. And as you and I gather around this table tonight, it's a time to remember not only his body given for us and the blood shed that we would have a new relationship with God, but it's also a time to remember we're proclaiming something tonight. We're proclaiming his death, his vicarious death, his payment for our sins, and not only our sins, but the sins of the world. And understand something. There is no one on the face of the earth today who has not had his sins forgiven. There are only people who have accepted it and those who haven't. To as many as received him, gave he the right to become the children of God. That is to all who believe in his name. Tonight we gather around this table and we remember, but we also proclaim. Proclaim his death until he comes again.
Amen.
And that's the real joy. He's coming again. Tonight, the Lord invites all who have claimed him as their Lord and Savior to come to his table. We invite you to come. Our Father, as we take this bread and cup tonight, and we gather in this place on this Good Friday, we commemorate your gift of your Son. We remember the life given freely by your Son, so that as we hold this bread and this cup, we can say it is good. We can be still and know you are God. And we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. it'll peel that little cellophane off the top. And you can take the bread. And Jesus said, this bread is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now if you'll peel back that cellophane, the top, and as you look at the redness of it, you realize that it symbolizes, as Jesus said, my blood of the new covenant. It meant the new relationship, the new arrangement, whereby our sins are forgiven and we have a friendship with God. Jesus said, all of you, drink of it. Our folks will come among you and they'll pass out these baskets and you can drop them in there. And as we come to the conclusion of this service tonight, I want you to watch a video. We watched it last year. It's a beautiful song. It was written by two sisters. Well, it was sung by two sisters to their mother who was in the hospital dying. And then it went viral. It went on YouTube. And I know many of you have seen it. It is truly a moving tribute to what Jesus did for us. So as we conclude our service tonight, sit back and watch this.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, did you forget me, Father? Did you? They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ. Then laid him down to rest inside.
3 days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice, anointing, hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ has risen, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
Sunday's coming. Yes. Hallelujah. And we hope we'll see you then. Let's stand together and let's pray. Oh, Lord, we come tonight and we can say it's Good Friday because what you did for us is beyond good. And all we can say is hallelujah. Lord, bless us for the next few days. Bring us back here for resurrection morning. Let hallelujah be written all over our hearts. Now bless us and keep us. Make your face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. Lord, lift up your countenance upon your people now. And may we have the peace of God that passes all understanding that comes to us because Christ died for sins once and for all, the just for the unjust, so that he could bring us to God. Thank you. And all of God's people said, amen. God bless you.